I'm copying him because he said just as much at the Haverhill City Council meeting a few weeks ago when he mentioned some of the great members of our class, like John Guerin,
Michael Young,
all these people that were involved in the Haverhill High School class of 1979. I'm wondering if we're almost to the level of the illustrious class of 1939. Probably not.
I don't know.
They had millionaires in their class or something.
There's still time for us.
Time is running out. All right. Well, the reason Councilor Tom Sullivan is with us today is to discuss the 52nd annual VFW Santa Parade that his father was well known for bringing to Haverhill for generations, I would say is a safe call.
Actually, I was thinking about this today. My father ran the parade for 21 years, and I've been involved now with the parade for 31 years. So I've actually eclipsed the number of years that my father actually was part of this event.
Isn't that incredible? Yeah. 31 years. Mm. You're in a rut.
Mm.
No. No. But
Not a rut. It's not a rut.
No, actually, I used to really enjoy your dad. He used to come to city council meetings for veteran services things, and he had a nice sly, if you will, sense of humor. Maybe you'd have a different term for it, but...
Well, how about the time you went advocating for more money for veterans in the Veterans Services Fund? And this was probably back in the 80s, if not the late 70s. And he went before the council advocating for more budget monies for veterans, and he reminded them in front of the microphone on camera that if it weren't for the veterans, they'd all be speaking Japanese or German right now. I think that's probably one of his funniest moments in front of the camera or in front of the city council anyway, but... That's who he was.
I remember another one where I remember Council President Ted Pelosi, after one of your dad's speeches, Councilor Pelosi said, well, we've got something for you. It was a bit of a surprise. The agenda wasn't as well known in advance in those days. And, your father looked up. We're giving you a raise. And your father's response was, well, it's about time. I think I deserve
it. He was a great
man. And
he did. A great man. He was a good character. He was a great soul.
My father was a veteran, and he enjoyed working with your dad. So
Yes.
So it worked out pretty well. But now, the VFW Santa Parade. Why don't you give us, well, let's first tell people when it is. So just in case you're making dinner, we'll say this several times. So it is going to be Sunday, November 20th.
Correct. It's less than 2 weeks away.
At 1 p.m. The usual. Now, if there's some inclement weather, it's the following Saturday at 10 a.m.
Right.
Very rarely has that
only
happened.
Only once.
Just once in
just
21
once.
Years?
Yeah. Well,
oh, isn't that incredible?
Once in 52 years that I'm aware of, but...
Oh, that's right. Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Now, tell us a little bit of the background of Santa Parade, in case there's some new listeners or people who haven't heard this before, but the Santa Parade... Replace something else.
Santa Parade goes back to 1964. The Chamber of Commerce at the time had ran an annual holiday parade, but come 1964, they decided to move on and they were not going to sponsor it anymore. My father had created, along with a bunch of veterans, a number of veterans from the VFW, they had started a drum corps, a senior drum corps, or junior drum corps, I think, back then. It would become a senior drum corps as the members got older. Had started a drum corps and wanted to showcase the new drum corps. Drum corps were a big thing back in the 60s and the 70s. So when the Chamber of Commerce decided to move on, the VFW Post 29 stepped up to the plate and decided they would become the sponsors and the organizers of the annual holiday parade. And here we are 52 years later, and this is still an ongoing annual event, and it's the longest and largest running consecutive event in the city of Haverhill, which is, there's something to be said for that. It's the start of Haverhill's holiday tradition. So many families participate in the parade. So many families watch the parade. They come from all over. A lot of people come back to their family homesteads, or they just come back to friends and family that still live here in Haverhill, and they make Parade Day a party. It's a celebration. And there's something to be said for any event that has that longevity and has grown to become what it is today, which is really the premier event, holiday event anyway, parade north of Boston.
I mean, it's incredible, frankly. All not only the thousands of people it attracts to view it, but the enormous number of participants and the floats that you attract. Can you give us a little hint at what one might expect if they've never been before? What kind of I think you have some special guest cartoon type characters.
Yeah, every year we try to do something a little different. We try to bring something new to the parade. This year we're bringing Wally and Tessie, the mascots for the Red Sox, as well as the mascot for the Lowell Spinners. They'll be our special guests in this year's parade. And anyone who has not been to this parade has to go to experience or to just see just what a large event this really is. So far we have 12 marching bands signed up. We'll probably end up with one or two more in the next week or two. 20 to 25 floats. The Hallamore Clydesdales are back. Every year the Hallamore horses, the Clydesdales from Hallamore Transportation Company, participate in our event. And not many people know this, but the Hallamore Clydesdales are the descendants of the original Hallamore Clydesdales who were sold. Some of those Clydesdales were sold to Budweiser back in the 30s.
Isn't that
That
incredible?
Is where the Budweiser Clydesdales originally came from, was from Hallamore Transportation. And Hallamore has been three or four generations now. This is a huge transportation company, and the owner has still this fondness for these Clydesdales, and he won't bring them to just any parade. They do not participate in very many parades. They'll only participate in the largest and the most well-organized parades, and ours is fortunately both of those things.
Well, speaking of which, it's a very expensive undertaking, and to the extent that you care to share, you still need some help this year?
Oh, yeah. I mean, our needs are great. Our budget is an open book. The parade typically costs anywhere between $40,000 and $45,000 a year. And if you ask, where does that money go? Well, the bulk of that money goes to pay for the marching bands that participate in the parade. For a long time, people thought parades, marching bands just come for free. You know, like, and who does anything for free today? And
that's
who
true.
Who can do anything for free? So, you know, even the high school marching bands, Londonderry, for example, with 250 personnel, one of the best bands in the region that come to our parade every year, I believe they charge $2,500 for their participation, which when you think about it.
Well, they have to buy uniforms
correct,
and equipment.
And band equipment and transportation costs. We don't begrudge any of them.
Probably the insurance to get there, just because
right.
That's our type of society we have.
Right. But so even the high school bands have to charge today. And again, we gladly pay them because we're thankful that they come, and they are very good. And music is important in the schools. So if this is how they are able to keep their bands going and make them even better every year, which they do, we're happy to contribute to that. So the large bulk of the costs go to the marching bands. And then there are expenses related to the floats, whether the float prizes, ribbons, advertising, posters, the miscellaneous costs. Nobody gets paid to be on the Santa Parade Committee. They are not paid positions. They're all volunteers. And I'd like to speak about the volunteers for a few minutes, because there are no veterans left on the VFW Santa Parade Committee. Unfortunately, all the veterans are gone. And if they're not gone, they're too old to be, part of the committee now. That doesn't mean that we don't value. We certainly value them. We cherish them. We do this in their memory. All of us who are involved are somehow connected to the veterans. My dad was a veteran. The Plourd family that has been involved in this parade for many years, and Dan Plourd is currently the chairman. Before Dan Plourd was Roland Plourd. He was the chairman, and before that was Joan Cranton. And before Joan was myself. I was the chairman for 15 years. But, we're happy to do this. It is the VFW Santa Parade. It will always be the VFW Santa Parade. And even as the veterans that were members of the Lorraine Post 29, even as they do pass, this lives on. And that's something
to
be
said.
It's
a nice tradition.
Yeah, there's something to be said about that.
Now, how does the committee raise funds? You just had a golf tournament. That seems like one of the ways.
We did. We had a very successful golf tournament thanks to a lot of hard work by a bunch of good people over at the Bradford Country Club. Can't say enough about the Murphy family, Kristen and Kevin and Tim Como, who manages the club. They were awesome, and they helped us raise a third of our budget this year, actually, we raised. So
really, that
well?
If
you do the math, it's almost $15,000. That was huge. We've never had such a one successful fundraiser, and it looks like it's headed in the right direction. We had 120 golfers. Which is a lot of golfers for any fundraising tournament. And it was a well-run tournament, so we thank them. We thank them for doing that. Other things that we do, we have a business boosters club where we solicit the business community. We have a family boosters raffle club, which is ongoing right now. We have a tag day that went on 2 weekends ago, and we collect money during the parade itself. So when you add it all up, we are usually in very good shape. We are able to pay our bills. Any funds left over go immediately into the parade for the following year.
All right. Now, tell us about the theme for this year.
Theme is a little different this year. It's inside Santa's workshop. And we're not requiring, but we're recommending or urging that all floats try to somehow reflect the theme. Even the Santa float is going to reflect this theme this year. It'll be a little different than what people have become accustomed to at the end of the parade.
Well, I understand Santa has brought in some automation. So we can turn out those electronic devices.
Yes. Yes. But anyway, you know, it's once again shaping up to be another great parade. In fact, when I leave here, I'll be going to the parade office to join the rest of the members of the parade committee who are will be having a meeting. It's our second to last meeting for the year. It's hard to believe it's here. It's always the Sunday before Thanksgiving, and we do it on that date, number one, because we hope the weather will cooperate, but number two, it has become our date for our parade so that all the bands that might go here and there and different communities...
We can pretty much predict.
They know it's predictable, and we're very successful in bringing back the best bands, and we do get the best bands. We have Londonderry, we have Salem, New Hampshire, we have Reading, we have Beverly... the Sons of Italy locally, the Haverhill, I'm pleased to report the Haverhill Middle School and High School Band is coming, and every year they're getting better and better, and I want to put a pitch in for them. They're at the point where they will be seeking funds, raising money for new uniforms. So pretty soon Haverhill Band will have brand new uniforms again, and that will be an awesome thing. Because as you know, when we were in high school, the band was remarkable. They were a great band back in the 60s and the 70s and even through the 80s. But when the budget cuts hit, it really decimated the music program in Haverhill. And we're happy that it's back. And we're happy that they're at the point where they may be getting new uniforms.
Wonderful, wonderful. Now, talk about, if you will, in the couple minutes that we have left, about some of the things that people should be aware of. Parking, where to watch, and for the new listeners, just the entire route. Where can they assemble?
Well, the parade always begins at the Hunking School, and in fact, we toured the Hunking School grounds today to make sure we can use the facility to set up, and it's in great shape. Happy to report that school is going to be amazing, and the grounds are very extensive, and we will be able to put our marching bands and everything else in there once again. So it starts there at Route 125 at the fire station with Hunking School in the back, and it ends in front of the VFW, which is on Route 110. So it proceeds down Route 125 from Bradford to Haverhill, and it takes a right in Monument Square onto Kenoza Avenue and stops in front of Lorraine Post 29. Best viewing spots are wherever you feel most comfortable watching a parade. I know that people in Bradford love to flock to South Main Street, and a lot of the homes there on the route will have parties and huge, huge event for a lot of the families. A lot of people watch it in Monument Square where the reviewing stand is located. It's a great spot to watch. The only spot that people tend to stay away from smartly, and especially on a very cold day, is watching it on the bridge. It can be very cold watching it on the Basilea Bridge. But some years when it's warm, though, we will find that people will actually be all across the bridge.
So, now, I didn't talk to you about this in advance, so I hope it's not a faux pas. I know that in the past, some businesses along the route have donated their parking spaces. Is that still true?
Yes, Driscoll Funeral Home,
That was the one I wanted to be careful to make sure he was doing it this
year. I'm pretty sure they do. They collect canned goods there. And they allow people to park in there. I might take that back. Driscoll's is undergoing a renovation project there.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, they're doing an addition on the back. So I'm not sure. We'll have to find out from Patrick. If Patrick's listening, he can call in and let us know.
978-374-1900.
There you go. We can ask him if he's able to do that this year with the construction going on.
Well, that's why I said I wanted to be careful not to have suddenly 50 cars show up and there's some construction equipment in the way. But there's obviously, it's a very long route. Places to park along the way, side streets.
There's always a number of side streets.
And that kind of thing. So the 52nd annual VFW Santa Parade takes place the Sunday
before Thanksgiving.
Before Thanksgiving.
2 weeks from yesterday.
2 weeks from yesterday. And if is there a schedule online or a list of floats or anything along those lines?
The parade roster will be available the week before the parade. That actually gets done this weekend. And you can go to our website, which is www.vfwsantaparade.com.
VFWSantaParade, all one word, .com.
Yep, .com, and you can check that the week of the parade.
All right. So, sounds like we have a lot of fun. And the mascots, one of them is new to this. Like Tessie is new?
Tessie is Wally's sister, I believe.
All right. So, folks, Wally and Tessie, there's a good chance to get out there.
Yep.
And I remember, I don't know why this is the memory I have, for attending for 30 years myself. Don't throw candy from the floats.
As much as we try to enforce that rule, it's broken every year. But we do urge participants not to do that because we don't want kids running into the parade lineup and perhaps running into the floats. So we do ask that the float organizers have volunteers to walk beside the float, handing the candy out, or at least throwing it into the crowd so that the crowd isn't coming into the street.
Oh, I see. I do remember that.
Knock on wood. You've never had a problem yet. Don't be jinxing us.
I'm not jinxing it. I'm just saying it's one of my memories. It's like a tradition. So I'm looking forward to it, as always, again this year. Route 125 from Bradford to Haverhill, folks. The Sunday before Thanksgiving, so, the holiday starts early here in Haverhill, but it's a great tradition. Tom, thanks for coming on
the
show.
Thank you for having me. Appreciate it.
Really appreciate that. Folks, we'll be going to open lines in just a few minutes. We thank Tom Sullivan for coming on the program and talking about the VFW Santa Parade, and we will be back with more of the Open Mic Show after this Mass Moment.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
Last year, WHAV helped local nonprofits by airing nearly 10,000 community spotlight messages. WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free.
Catch the wave!
Suspense, a weekly anthology of notable melodramas from stage and screen, fiction and radio, presented every Monday night to bring you to the edge of your chair, to keep you in suspense. Listen to the new Suspense with a company of Hollywood actors and surprising guest stars Monday nights at 10 with encore performances at 1 a.m. right here on WHAV. Remember, only local radio can bring you this feature opportunity, but only WHAV does.
Today is November 7th. On this day in 2002, the Islamic Society of Boston held a ceremonial groundbreaking in Roxbury for New England's largest mosque and Islamic cultural center. The society had grown from a handful of Cambridge-based students in the 1970s to more than 250 families. The effort to build a new facility met with controversy and delay. In 1999, the city sold the society a piece of land, but it took years to complete the permitting process, overcome neighborhood resistance, and find a way around the Islamic prohibition against borrowing money at interest. Then 9/11 aroused anti-Muslim prejudice and accusations of extremism. The Islamic Society defended itself and persisted. The $22 million mosque and cultural center is scheduled to open in the winter of 2006. For more about this and other Mass Moments, go online to massmoments.org. Brought to you by the Massachusetts Foundation for the Humanities.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
This is the Open Mic Show on 97.9 FM WHAV. Thank you for joining us. Open lines for the rest of the program, 978-374-1900. 978-374-1900. If you're watching the show on either Channel 22 in Haverhill or WHAV.tv on your computer, then you also can see the phone number at all times at the bottom of the screen. But for radio listeners, 978-374-1900. Okay, we are taking December birthdays and anniversaries. If you know someone having a birthday in December or a couple having an anniversary in December, then you pick up the phone, come on the show, and say, I want to wish happy birthday to Mabel or happy anniversary to Al and Gertrude, what have you. And it's that easy. Chris will take the name ahead of time, goes into the hat, and we do a drawing. Now, all of the birthday wishes, we went through them again this week, and there was a couple of people, or at least one person, who said they did not get the letter, and of course we believe them. I don't think they'll show up 2 days in a row or anything, but when you advise the recipient that this is coming in the mail so they don't think that it's junk mail. It'll say WHAV on the outside envelope. We're beginning to think that a lot of recipients didn't expect it, didn't know that their name was mentioned or that they won. So if you are listening to the program when the winner is announced, 8:15, usually the last Monday of the month or the last Monday that there is an open mic show broadcast, then let them know that their name was called and they'll be receiving an envelope from WHAV. Now, we really do thank our friends at Albi D's Second Generation Italian Bakery, 140 South Main Street in Bradford, for providing these cakes at no charge to WHAV or to the recipient. Recipients receive a free 7-inch cake, choice of vanilla or chocolate, and all have sugar frosting. Really delightful. So keep that in mind. Let people know, but everyone should be up to date now. Now, speaking of where and how to listen to WHAV, really encourage people to use FM 97.9. A lot of money went into putting this on the air. A lot of years went into getting this on the air. So get into the habit of listening to 97.9. You can wake up to news every morning, local weather, every 30 minutes, all day long, 24 hours a day, local news twice an hour, weekdays. On Monday night, we'll have a little bit later. Then there's late news at 11 o'clock. Really encourage you to do that. And then if you are maybe you're traveling to New York or on business, you're driving your car, well, then try out the stream at whav.net. on your computer or smartphone. You can use the TuneIn app. It's in the app stores for Android and for iPhones. You can do that. Find WHAV on there, and you can take WHAV wherever you go worldwide. So that's certainly a plus about the new technology. Now, this Saturday, WHAV is participating in something that was fun. Now, again, we horned in on it is what we did, but when the Kiwanis Club of Haverhill said they were having their first annual turkey drop Saturday, 1 o'clock at Murphy's Garrison Golf, well, WHAV had to be involved. Now, why is that? Well, maybe you're young or maybe you missed the show when it was on, but there was a television show in the 70s called WKRP in Cincinnati, and there was a holiday show. It was actually the seventh show of the series, and there was a holiday show where the general manager of the radio station decided to have a little promotion for Thanksgiving, and he had turkeys pushed out of a helicopter, live turkeys. Well, that's not what Kiwanis Club is doing. Kiwanis Club is having rubber turkeys drop from a helicopter, and you can buy a square, buy a ticket, and there'll be squares on the ground, and if the rubber turkey with a prize note attached lands on your square, you win the prize. It's pretty exciting. We're very, very pleased that Kiwanis Club is doing that, but it did have quite a legend on television, and I think some of you may remember some classic lines from the TV show, and Les Nessman, the newsman.
Oh my God, they're talking! Oh, Johnny, can you get this? Oh, they're crashing to the earth right in front of our eyes! One just went through the windshield of a parked car! This is terrible,
they're running around pushing each other?
Yes, that was Les Nessman, the WKRP news person. Now, we thought about having some contests, Les Nessman announcers, that kind of thing. But now we'll have some surprises, I think, that day. But we're really very pleased that the Kiwanis Club is having its first annual turkey drop. It's going to get a lot of attention from radio people. We're very pleased that Rich Porcelli was on the program from Kiwanis a couple weeks ago. And I just want to remind you again, first annual turkey drop, Saturday, November 12th, 1 o'clock, Murphy's Garrison Golf.
As God is my witness, I thought turkeys could fly.
Now, that's true. And for our TV viewers, Chris, we do have a graphic for this, don't we, of Les Nessman doing the announcements in kind of a Hindenburg disaster-style announcement. We will assume there'll be no disasters, but just a lot of fun. And I really encourage all of you. Actually, today, WHAV has the tickets. They're $10 each. We have them at the front desk here at the studio in Ward Hill. You can get them at other places as well. But today we sold a couple of tickets. So Kiwanians, we're trying to do our part. We really appreciate that you're having this event. And, of course, all the funds go to support local charities. Kiwanis, just like the other service clubs, does a wonderful job in the community, and we're really very proud of them. So Kiwanis Club of Haverhill, first annual turkey drop. Did we have a slide for that?
I can't find it.
Well, it might be in the folder. Maybe we didn't save it. But in any event, we'll get back to that. Just a couple minutes before we go to local news, and really it was a very, very heavy news day. Some of you received the WHAV newsletter, daily newsletter, with links to some of the headlines of stories and the web version of these reports from WHAV. But after sending out that newsletter today, we had some more stories. There are some police investigations going into to two major accidents this weekend, beginning Friday night. One, a person was struck by a truck on River Street. We have an update on what police are doing with that. And a car flipped over on Water Street Saturday. And there's a graphic and in-depth stories at WHAV.net. If you want to get these emailed news reminders, just go to the bottom of the page at WHAV.net and there's a place where you can sign up. You won't be spammed. You have a choice of getting the daily newsletter, which is, you know, Monday through Friday, but also you might want to check the Wavelengths extra monthly newsletter. That includes some great feature stories like the Haverhill Heritage series that David Gousewood writes about, and he just did one recently, and there's been some real classics among those. So I think this would be something you would enjoy, if just as a reminder. And also remind your friends, 97.9, put it a preset on your car radio. You know, it's been so long since WHAV was on FM that we've heard from people saying, oh, I keep forgetting. What is that number again? Well, it's 97.9. All right. When we come back from the news, now we're going to try something here. We're all going to be polite. We're going to be friendly no matter who you're voting for tomorrow night. Here's a little challenge for you. Tell the listeners, what your plans are. Maybe you've already voted. Were you an early voter? Call and tell us about that experience. Were you one of the people lined up on the stairs in City Hall? Two stories worth of stairs last week on the last day of early voting. Pretty incredible. If you would like, you don't have to, no obligation, tell us who you're voting for and why. You don't have to limit it to the presidential race. Maybe you want to tell us about your state rep. Haverhill has, what, three? Is it four? We have Linda Dean Campbell. We have Diana DeZoglio. Some people, I think, have Lenny Mira. And, of course, Brian Dempsey has the bulk of the city. So tell us who you're voting for or why. If you don't want to say who, that's fine. Maybe tell us some of the things on your mind. Maybe you want to comment on the ballot questions, or maybe you want to ask a question about the ballot questions. But let's go to local news with WHAV News Director Dana Esmo, and we'll be back with more of the Open Mic Show right after that.
Open Mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
It's 7:01.
Radiating from high above the Queen Slipper City on Silver Hill, this is WHAVLP Haverhill, Greater Haverhill's home for information and entertainment.
Here's what's happening in local news. A search by Essex County authorities continues for two men who walked away last Wednesday from the Minimum Security Correctional Alternative Center in Lawrence. Manuel Perez, 22, and Levi Montalvo, 23, both originally from Puerto Rico, are still at large, Essex County Sheriff's Department Chief Financial Officer Barbara Marr told WHAV Monday. She declined to further comment about an ongoing search, including leads or search area, for concern of jeopardizing the effort to locate the escapees. The Sheriff's Department released photographs of Perez and Montalvo Thursday evening, one day after Sheriff Frank G. Cousins reported the two walked away from the center, also known as the farm. Perez has several tattoos on his hands and forearm, including the Puerto Rican flag on his right hand. Montalvo has tattoos of skulls on his abdomen, back, and left arm, the Sheriff's Department said. Anyone with information is asked to call 978-750-1900, extension 3302. The causes of two motor vehicle accidents in Haverhill over the weekend, including one Friday which injured a pedestrian on River Street, remain under investigation by Haverhill Police. Haverhill Fire Department rescue and pumper units from the Water Street Station assisted at the scene of a single-vehicle rollover crash reported at 6:59 p.m. Saturday at the intersection of Water and Groveland Streets. One person with minor injuries was transported to Holy Family Hospital, Haverhill, according to Haverhill Fire Chief William F. LaLiberty. He did not identify the person involved, whose current condition was unknown. On Friday afternoon, an unidentified pedestrian, seriously injured after being struck by a truck near the intersection of River and Beach Streets, was treated on scene by rescue crews before being transported to Lawrence General Hospital and later med-flighted to a Boston hospital, La Liberty added. An engine unit from High Street Station also responded to the accident scene. A Haverhill police spokesperson was unavailable for further comment. More lane shifts and temporary lane closures are expected as the ongoing Methuen Rotary Reconstruction Project at the junction of Interstate 93 and Routes 110 and 113 proceeds toward completion and opening a new southbound highway on-ramp, according to an update Monday from Massachusetts Department of Transportation. Daytime single lane closures are to be expected on I-93 northbound from 5:30 a.m. to 2 p.m., I-93 southbound from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., and on local roads from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Overnight, double lane closures on I-93 southbound are expected from 10 p.m. to 5 a.m. The $66.4 million rotary replacement project is 76% complete, and construction is scheduled to end summer 2018, MassDOT said. The Haverhill Democratic City Committee is offering free rides to the polls on Election Day Tuesday. Any registered voter needing a ride to their voting precinct may call 978-476-6966 to arrange transportation. For more information, contact Roz McKeon, Headquarters Chair, at 978-373-4032 or Bill Cox, City Committee Chair, at 978-374-6297. Stay tuned to WHAV for national and local election coverage beginning at 7 p.m. Tuesday. WHAV will interrupt network programs as local election results are known. Remember, WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free. In the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom, this is Dana Esmail.
From Feature Story News in Washington, I'm Daniel Renches. Hillary Clinton's retaining a small advantage in newly published polling data in the final hours of campaigning before Election Day begins. Donald Trump's appealing to voters who feel disadvantaged by globalization and the current political elite in Washington. The Clinton campaign is being aided by last-minute appearances by President Obama and celebrities including Bruce Springsteen and Lady Gaga in key swing states. Our Washington correspondent Simon Mark says the momentum is in Hillary Clinton's favor after the FBI dismissed the possibility of a criminal case over its email investigation.
Well, still pretty good news for Hillary Clinton. I mean, the latest survey that CBS News has published suggests that she's 5 points clear of Donald Trump nationally going into Election Day. Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, of course, barnstorming through those all-important battleground states on this final day of America's presidential election campaign. But the Clinton campaign still can't really, I think, take anything for granted. Donald Trump is determined to do what he can to energize his supporters, the last chance he says they'll ever get. He argues there'll never be another opportunity like this one for the disenfranchised, as he would define them, people who have lost their jobs, seen their opportunities exported out of the country, watched industries retrench, particularly in states like Ohio and Pennsylvania. He says this is their last chance to send a message to the political establishment that they want to overturn America's political apple cart.
Philippines President Rodrigo Duterte says he's cancelled an order of weapons from the United States after the sale was stopped by the State Department. The top U.S. Democrat on the Foreign Relations Committee blocked the planned sale of 26,000 assault rifles after reports from human rights organizations citing several thousand extrajudicial killings since the start of Duterte's war on drugs. U.S. correspondent Mimi Charmen reports from New York.
President Duterte said the Philippines will just have to look for another source of firearms. That's according to local reports citing a speech delivered on Monday by the president, who suggested just a few weeks ago that he could source weapons from Russia if the U.S. were to block the sale. The development comes as relations between the U.S. and the Philippines have grown strained in recent months over Duterte's pushback against Washington's criticism of his war on drugs. A few weeks ago, President Duterte clarified a headline-grabbing statement he made about severing ties with the U.S., saying that what he meant was a separation of foreign policy, not an end to diplomatic relations. Mimi Chahman, New York.
Prosecutors in Germany have confirmed that they've widened their investigation into Volkswagen's emissions cheating scandal, to include the carmaker's current chairman. This is FSN.
WHAV Weather!
I'm WHAV meteorologist Gary Best with WHAV Weather. With generally clear skies, it's going to be a chilly night, low temperature close to 32, and then for Election Day Tuesday, mostly sunny and turning milder, a bit over 60. Increasing clouds, about 40 at night, mostly cloudy with a chance of showers developing Wednesday, high temperature 54 to 58. This is Gary Best. Your next WHAV Weather coming up in 30 minutes.
Try listening to WHAV in your car or anywhere on your mobile phone. For fast access, visit WHAV.net. Broadcasting on the Armstrong FM system, this is 97.9 WHAV.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
And welcome back, 97.9 WHAV FM. This is the Open Mic Show. You know, try it in your car on the way to work, on the way home. 97.9, make it a permanent preset in your car. Many people are discovering, many of you just were on their way to work and you know, there were other complicated ways you could listen to WHAV before, but now you can get the news on the way to work, find out what's happening. Matter of fact, all this month, those of you who have to travel by the old Methuen Rotary, that interchange is all changing, but they're doing more work. So you'll get updates on your commute as well in the morning. So be sure, 97.9 on your car radios. Okay, we're going to go to the phones in just a second, but there was some old business from last week's broadcast, and I didn't get to it, but there were some questions about the cemeteries, what happened to them when they built the Quabbin Reservoir and took four towns off the map. If you don't know that story, look it up in the Swift River Valley. Pretty interesting, but there were four towns in Massachusetts that were literally wiped off the map. They were disincorporated, I guess that's the word, taken out, and all the homes were demolished. Some actually were moved, but the cemeteries were kind of interesting, and David Goudswood had some information on this. First of all, the towns are Dana, Greenwich, Prescott, and Enfield. No, not Dana Esmo Chris. Chris is laughing. He thought Dana was a town that had been removed from the map. No. Not that Dana. Dana, Greenwich, Prescott, Enfield, all those dwellings had to be demolished. And although the roads and cellar holes still remain underwater, David Goudswood wrote 7,561 bodies from the town cemeteries, some dating back to 1741, needed to be relocated. Approximately 6,500 of those graves and town memorials were relocated to Quabbin Park Cemetery on Route 9 in Ware. And that's what I was thinking of last week. I think it was Jerry from Methuen who was talking about this. You know, environmentally, I don't think we could ever pull this off again today. But it was pretty incredible. But one of the complaints had been about how people were rather strangely relocated, their graves strangely relocated. But let's go to the phones right now. Let's find out what you think. You are on the Open Mic Show.
Yes, I remember you and Jerry talking about that on the phone.
No, I this is why I have to check my messages. David went through all this trouble of researching it. He's the Open Mic Show historian. And, of course, it was Halloween when we discussed it. And so graves and Halloween kind of go together, and I didn't even look at it. So there we go.
So we used to have 355? cities and towns in Massachusetts?
Well, what I don't know is, see, there's one for David. Sorry, David. What I don't know is whether what the number was. Maybe we've subdivided a few towns since then and created some more. But, you know, that's a really good question, Brian.
I don't know.
I mean, maybe, I mean, there's been a lot of talk that we might add Devens as a town, but I don't know if that idea has gone by the wayside or what. So, you know, towns do prop up. I mean, Massachusetts lost a town in 1896 when Bradford was merged with Haverhill.
Oh,
so,
right.
So, you know, the numbers do change, but this was much later. That was in the last century, and that's a good question, a really good question, Brian. All right, so we were thinking about you last week when we put out some letters and finding out how lucky people are to have you as their friend, because you give away, you put their names into the Albidee's second generation Italian bakery cake hat, and you have a great track record that people you know have, and this is all on the up and up, folks, have won the cake. So,
well, you know what's funny is, well, I did miss October. Somebody in Lawrence won that one, but for November, I called that one in just that night, you know, and it was really lucky. And it was a 7-year-old boy, and you know him as Edwin.
Oh, right.
His nickname is Babel. I believe his sister made up that nickname, Babel.
And say it again.
Thrilled. He is thrilled, and he has the certificate.
Okay. See, we Diane, by the way, and you know, many people hear Diane doing community spotlight, but Diane Carr is the person who gets these letters out, and that's why I'm simply suggesting. And I'm not sure that was the case here. Maybe we dropped the ball somewhere along the way, but let the recipient know if they have won, so they're expecting this. Okay. Well. Yeah. So I think we caught up. One of your other winners. Also got a letter that we somehow either overlooked or
yep,
got lost in the mail.
What? Know, so it was the same address, and they came in the same mailing.
Say that again?
That arrived in the same mail, because that's a mother and son duo for birthdays. Only hers was July, and his is November.
Oh, okay. Well, that's interesting. So there you go. So what's on your mind tonight, Brian? Oh, you're already starting on your December birthdays.
I am.
Now, there you go.
That's Nick, and he won last year.
Nick?
I've been calling him in for years, but he finally won last year, and so we'll see how he does this year.
Now, it's funny you say years. We have been at this a while, haven't we?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, even the new incarnation, I think, you know, I'm losing track of time. When did we, was it 7 years ago that we brought Open Mike back with Jack Bevilacqua?
I don't know.
And, of course, then it was on the air for 40 years before that.
Yeah, right. But, see, when you had some other hosts on there that I just kind of got away from it. And so I never listened when
Lindsay Parker, when she was on. That's right. So did you listen when Bill Pike was the host?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Bill Pike is the one everyone remembers. Bill Pike on the Open Mic. Ed Johnson always said that they had to change the name of the show to make it rhyme. Or they had to pick him because his name rhymed. I can't remember the.
Oh, and you said it was started originally by Mr. Johnson.
Yeah, you know, what makes it unclear is in those days, the idea of putting people on the air was such a risk because they had no method of delaying anyone in case they accidentally used a bad word or something like that. So Ed Johnson said he would put the phone to his ear, and the people would say, well, I'm calling about the trash pickup on, you know, Lancaster or whatever. And then he would then, listeners, this caller is calling about the trash. Okay, now, what is it, miss? Oh, I see. They didn't take your barrel. Okay, yes. Oh, and they dented the, remember the old steel barrels? I mean, this is the kind of thing people talked about on open mic. The steel barrels would get dented when they banged them on the truck. And, yeah, and, we don't have
well,
that problem.
I remember. I was a little kid, and I remember my father calling the show. Of course, I didn't know who Edwin Johnson was, but my father called, and I remember the old Zenith radio on top of the fridge. And my father's talking on the phone, and then the guy on the radio was answering.
Right. Oh, I see. And then later, they came up with this rather ingenious method of delaying by putting two reel-to-reel tape recorders, you know, so many feet apart, and then they would record on the top machine, and then a very long piece of tape would play back on the bottom machine, and that created the delay.
Yeah.
And we're looking at some digital things. They're pretty fancy these days. There's one where we can either slow the audio down or speed it up to replace the element that we had to delete. Luckily, not too many people test us with that. And please don't, because Chris is on the switch. He'll stop you in a second. But some of the modern ones also will, you know, put in a kind of a funny cartoon sound or something in place of the offending term.
Sure.
And then I remember, I don't know if I should admit this now. I wonder. This is something that as a kid producing the open mic show for Bill Pike, I wonder if I can safely reveal it now. But there were times, not I wasn't the only one, someone would actually say something very innocent, and we would block it so everyone would think that person swore. I don't know if I should admit that now, but I remember. Here's a real example, and I hope you know. I was just 17 or something like that. But Clara Freelander used to call the program. She was our rep on the Whittier Vote Tech Board, and Clara would call and say, "I don't know what it is about these kids. They have hair down to their." And I would pull the switch back, so it sounded like she said something she didn't say.
Yeah, that's funny.
Should I have admitted that, Chris? My integrity is destroyed now. I don't know, but I was just a kid. All right, so it depends what you call the beginning of the open mic show, whether it was those days when Edwin Johnson would paraphrase, or was it later? I mean, I think most people like to associate it with Bill Pike, but I think that goes back, well, that's probably 50 years by itself there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I would say so. And I barely remember the one with Mr. Johnson because I was just a little kid. But I just faintly remember it.
So you do. Because now, in 1954, there was a show called Assignment Haverhill at this time slot. And that 1954 is the year I think Ed Johnson went from full-time at the radio station to part-time.
Uh-huh.
And that's when he went to Haverhill High School as an English and public speaking instructor.
Uh-huh.
And but so then he worked really from 4 o'clock on, so after school. And he and then in the summer he would fill in on other shifts. But I believe that was the beginning of the nighttime talk program. But you know, I'm someone with a better memory. I guess I could just research looking at old radio listings in old Haverhill Gazettes at the library. And maybe I'll do that sometime. Not that anyone else cares, but...
Well, it's a rich history.
Yeah, well, there's just so much. But anyway, all right, so it's Nick's birthday in December. Do you know the day?
The 30th.
The 30th. All right. I believe, I'm trying to think, actually, you know, my memories are getting a little poor now. I believe a regular contributor to the Open Mic Show has a birthday in December. I have to check this.
Uh-huh.
But if I recall correctly, I don't know if it was on Christmas or close to Christmas, but this person, I believe, was damaged as a child because your grandparents would just buy one gift. They said it was bigger than they normally would have gotten, but it was to cover both things, Christmas and the birthday.
Wow.
I wonder how many people had that experience. Oh, well. Well, thank you very much, Brian.
Okay, and before I forget, tell Dana... Closure is not the right word. Everybody all over the country is saying closure. It's the incorrect use of the word closure. If you're going to talk about a lane closing, it's a lane closing. If it's a school closing, it's a school closing.
Okay. Actually, I wonder, we probably got that from Mass Department of Transportation, but I'm glad you corrected us because we can correct them. You know, there's quite a few words like that that have become, like police always say, drunk drivers. And my new morning editor, morning news editor, she says it's drunken drivers. So I think there are a lot of those terms that sneak into our vocabulary from government agencies.
Oh, yeah.
So that's a very good call,
well,
Brian.
Well, there are a lot of things, too, like, what's another one people say all the time? Oh, nor'easter.
Oh.
Now, I don't know who started that.
Probably somebody in Maine.
Outsider, but now even the natives here are saying it. And well, I know that, what's his name, Mr. Agreed with me there, Barney Gallagher.
Oh, yes. Well, Barney was a stickler for things like that.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no, someone thought it was folksy. It probably wasn't even someone from New England. Just someone who thought they knew how
new... Yeah, that's what we were supposed to say, nor'easter, and now people are starting to say it.
Of course, it reminds me of... I went to New Orleans, and people didn't know what I was referring to, because they call it Nawlins.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I didn't think you got to find that some other place. Where are New Orleans?
Well, some people say New Orleans.
Yeah, well, if you can overpronounce maybe the end of it, just like the same people. I think I've caught myself doing it, too. It's the state of Illinois, not the state of Illinois.
Oh, yeah.
It's kind of like a Langlois.
That's right.
Langlois. Illinois.
One of my high school teachers would... leave the S off anyway and say Langlois.
Oh, right. Well, they figured it was the same thing. Little did we know that we've been mispronouncing the state all this time. It's Illinois.
That's right.
Who knows? Maybe that'll happen. You know, but there are plenty of those in speech. I mean, Los Angeles, what we say today, but if you listen to old recordings, people said Los Angeles.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've heard that before.
So, I don't know. Maybe speech just evolves. All I know that's evolving, though, is Chris. I think he's got a sledgehammer in there. I know. I'll take my break in a minute. Okay. So, anyway. Well, Brian, thank you very much.
All right. And I'll be talking to you.
Oh, one last question. So, have you already voted? Did you do early voting?
No, I'm going to vote tomorrow.
Now, I think I want to go vote tomorrow, too, instead of... the early one just didn't seem like election day. But with all the people who have turned out, we may actually have had a majority already vote in Haverhill. We may already know
maybe
the winners.
So. Well, Bill Find, the guy in charge of Channel 5, gave an editorial about, you know, how the Tuesday came to be. You know, where it was just, talk about folksy. It was the most convenient time yesteryear.
Oh, is that what it was?
They're saying that the early voting opportunity is a good thing. Now, what I don't know is if I had gone over for early voting, would they have had my AccuMark voting machine there?
Oh, that's good.
They probably did, but I don't know.
That's an interesting question. It's an interesting question. We'll have to ask Linda about that. This will happen now all the time, so we'll see how it goes in the future.
Well, maybe one of the listeners who did vote early noticed the machine was there, or maybe somebody there was one of the people who set it up.
Yeah, I have to admit, is there one of these at every precinct?
Supposed to be.
I mean, you would think they would be, but I had never thought of it, Brian. That's
the law.
You bring things to our attention. Very good point. Very good point. I wonder if anyone else knows that. Well, thank you, Brian, for your call. I really do appreciate it.
Okay, you can take your break now, and I'll be in touch.
All right, that's fine. We're going to take a community spotlight break, and then a couple minutes later take a weather break so we can let Chris catch up. Thank you. Good night, Brian. All right, so let's go to Community Spotlight. Pretty late. Here I am again, off schedule. Take a Community Spotlight break. We'll be back. We're going to talk a little bit more, take your phone calls, and then we'll have local weather from meteorologists right here in the Merrimack Valley at 97.9 WHAV-FM.
Open mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back.
Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
For more in-depth coverage of the news, visit WHAV's website at whav.net.
Catch the wave!
The most trusted man in America, news anchor Walter Cronkite, once said, "It is absolutely essential in a democracy to have competition in the media, a lot of competition." That sentiment is one of the driving forces behind WHAV's expanded local news effort. This is News Director Dana Esmail inviting you to listen to my hourly weekday newscasts right here on WHAV. You'll also find the area's most comprehensive local news reporting at whav.net on your computer or smartphone. Remember, WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free.
And that's the way it is.
Community Spotlight.
A brain injury support group for survivors and caregivers takes place on the second Tuesday of each month. The group meets from 6 to 7:30 p.m. at Whittier Rehabilitation Hospital, Seminar Room, 145 Ward Hill Ave, Bradford. Groups are hosted by the Brain Injury Association of Massachusetts. More information is available by calling Tress Ricker at 800-242-0030, extension 13, or Caroline Keeney, Whittier Rehab Hospital, at 978-469-1453. Someone you know is on WHAV. To submit or read your own nonprofit announcements, click on the Contact tab at whav.net or email news at whav.net. In the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom, this is Diane Carr.
WHAV Open Mic.
From the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
And welcome back to the Open Mic Show, 97.9 FM, WHAV. Well, David Gounsworth has apparently responded. He called to tell us to check, but I don't know if it's, this is the electronic age, whether the computer cache won't refresh or what, but I don't see a new comment. But we always put David Gounsworth to work. And actually, I would have liked to have talked to him because I'm thinking he has a December birthday, but I might be wrong. Why don't I remember that? You know, I'm just, well, David's the same age. Or is he? That's a good question. Good question. Okay, folks, tomorrow is Election Day. WHAV will be joining the Pacifica Network for 5 hours of special programming beginning at 7 o'clock tomorrow night. 7 o'clock tomorrow night on 97.9 WHAV with a different perspective, a different take on the election. You know, many issues didn't get covered by the mainstream media because, well, they're not popular or what have you. Well, Amy Goodman and Juan Gonzalez from Democracy Now! Are going to be bringing you those perspectives that weren't covered during the election. Issues like climate change, whether you agree or disagree with it, my view is that the science seems pretty compelling, but whether you agree or disagree, you might want to know what other people think about issues like that. And so tomorrow night from 7 o'clock on WHAV. Now, we will interrupt the network feed from time to time with some local results. The biggest one that I think most local people are interested in would be the sheriff's race. The sheriff's race seems to be the one that's garnered the most interest. Some of you may have gone to Brian, Representative Brian Dempsey's pre-election breakfast yesterday. I was there. And by the way, one of our listeners, and I'll use her name, Marcel, was so wonderful. I have to tell you, really love Marcel. She said, Tim, you look like you've lost weight. I mean, you know, that's just the best thing I could hear, because on the camera adds 20 pounds, and I was up at least that already, but I have lost 20 pounds, and it was so nice of Marcel to notice, and I really appreciated that. Let's go. I think we do have a caller now, but let's go to local weather, because I promised it. Let's go to local weather, find out what tomorrow is going to be like, so those of you who haven't voted yet will have some idea. We'll be right back.
Open mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
It's 7:35.
Stay informed each day with local news, coupled with FSN's worldwide coverage. WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free.
Catch the wave!
Hi, I'm meteorologist Gary Best. Do you need to know if it's going to be hot or cold, wet or dry? Well, find out every half hour, 7 days a week with WHAV Weather. I'll keep you in touch with up-to-the-minute reports covering the greater Merrimack Valley and beyond. It's WHAV for accurate weather when you want it.
WHAV Weather!
I'm WHAV meteorologist Gary Best with WHAV Weather. With generally clear skies, it's going to be a chilly night, low temperature close to 32, and then for Election Day Tuesday, mostly sunny and turning milder, a bit over 60. Increasing clouds, about 40 at night, mostly cloudy with a chance of showers developing Wednesday, high temperature 54 to 58. This is Gary Best. Your next WHAV Weather coming up in 30 minutes.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
And welcome back to 97.9 FM, WHAV, and the Open Mic Show. Okay, now I can see why I did not see David Goudswood's comments. For some reason, he triggered the moderation filter. And there are no bad words, I can assure you. But for whatever reason, it required the moderator to approve them, which I have done from my phone. Yeah, and in case you're wondering sometimes why a comment is held for moderation, well, I don't know. The system sometimes picks at random. If you use a link, which David did not do, but if you use a link in your message to whav.net, that might hold it up. And then... frankly, I'm usually the only one doing this, so if I'm on the air and you're waiting for your comment to go through, it's because I'm on the air and not doing that. But David has some very interesting information about cities and towns in Massachusetts, but luckily we got him to call. So, David, you are on the Open Mic Show.
Hello, Tubby.
Tubby, thank you. Marcel, he called me Tubby. All right. Hey, actually, is your birthday in December?
No.
January.
Actually, I don't know anybody whose birthday is in December.
I know somebody that I'm forgetting, then, if it's not you.
Oh, one of the O'Malley girls.
Huh, that's interesting. Well, you want to call that in?
No. Well, one, because I don't remember which one for certain, and two, not my problem. I didn't get none of that cake. I live in Florida.
All right, Florida. Oh, there's another pronunciation we'll remember. Like I don't know why your comments triggered the moderation filter.
I don't either, except that for reasons too complicated to explain, I watch the program using Chrome, But because of the way Chrome is reacting with the television, the flash picture and sound, I have to go to Firefox and pull up the chat board. So perhaps some reason the chat board is not working properly on Firefox when it normally would on, I don't understand it.
Well, actually, I have to say, I want to revamp our WHAV.TV thing because I discovered last week that I didn't like the way it was performing either. You know, it's technology. It's a moving target. We're always changing it.
Yeah, it is.
But in any event, you had some information about the number of cities and numbers of cities and towns in Massachusetts around the time or since. I'm not really sure which one you're responding to.
It's current. The stuff I have is current. There are currently 296 towns and 55 cities, and that's just a. As you know, that's just a legal.
Okay, 296 towns, 55 cities, and then you also tell us about the largest city.
Population-wise, and I'm sure this is no surprise to anyone, the largest city by population is Boston. The largest city in terms of square miles is Plymouth, which has like a scooch under 100 square miles to its name.
Isn't that interesting that you would think that, you know, Plymouth gave up a lot of territory over the years, but must have been just, well, it was an entire colony at one time, wasn't it?
Yeah. Keep in mind, when they were giving out land grants, nobody had any idea how much material they were getting. So Massachusetts was given everything, and you know the shape of Massachusetts, of course, is predominantly a rectangle as you head west. Well, that rectangle extended infinitely.
Oh, really?
Because they didn't know how big the country was. And so the first thing that happened is New York was given property, and, of course, the two had the same piece of property all of a sudden. And then, of course, New Hampshire and the boundary following the river, but not following the river, paralleling the river X number of miles above it. Yeah, it was a mess. Virginia had everything going straight due west and on that north western slope, so basically they had everything all the way up to, well, I guess it would be around Oregon.
Oh, okay. Now, you make another interesting point, which I think might answer Brian's question.
Yeah, the newest town in terms of legal incorporation is East Brookfield, which is 1920. And I have to look, I did not look up where East Brookfield is, but I don't recognize that one at all. And the newest city is actually Gardner, which is 23. So we haven't added any new municipalities for, you know, 90 years, close to 100.
Well, that's interesting. Okay, so then we're probably then at 355 cities and towns at the time of the Quabbin Reservoir Project.
23, yeah, because the Quabbin went in the 30s.
Right. In 1927, I think it was it was going to be condemned, but I don't think they actually took them off the map until the late 30s.
Well, they did fight it for a little while. They had no chance at all of winning, but they did fight it.
They did fight it, and then I think as the Depression wore on, people thought, you know what, there's no work out here anyway. We'll take what we can get for the sale of our property and move on.
And East Brookfield was taken away from Brookfield, which is Worcester County.
Okay.
So, but you've got, I mean, keep in mind, when you count the states, I mean, it's like when you count the cities. We had 13 states to start with, and we had a lot less towns. You know, you're talking Gloucester, before it became Gloucester, it was like Cape Ann. Depends on how far back you want to go.
No, that's a good point. Just like the Merrimack Port and Newbury Port, the ports can.
North Andover.
Sure, there's another one. Yeah, quite a bit of these. Actually, we had an odd comment, speaking of towns. I think it passed through to the website earlier today, but a comment. Someone said that we really need to distinguish between Haverhill, Mass., and Haverhill, New Hampshire when we do police reports. Well, Our policy is no. If it is in Haverhill, New Hampshire, you'll see the NH after. But in a police report, I guess someone up in Haverhill, New Hampshire, this is my guess, someone up in Haverhill, New Hampshire, was contacted. It said their name appeared in the police reports. Well, no. There was a person with the same name in Haverhill, Massachusetts, but I don't think
it does bring up an interesting technology issue because, yes, your radio broadcast would never go that far north, but
the website
does. The interwebby thing. That's global.
You know, I have to say, I guess I feel for the person if he got a call saying, hey, I just looked out on the web and I see you were arrested. And they go, no, I wasn't arrested. What are you talking about? Well, there it is right there. And, well, that was a Haverhill, Massachusetts person, not a Haverhill. But I guess that's a valid point. I just would hate to start having to put, many local people would be offended if you had to put Massachusetts or Mass or MA next to the city every time we mentioned it.
Well, yeah, there is that. On the other hand, let's worry about it the first time you have a Haverhill, Minnesota problem.
Oh, I know, and of course that's a favorite topic that David and I have been discussing, and you'll learn more about that down the road on the Haverhill Heritage Series. If I could tease it a little bit, David.
Feel free.
All right, David's doing some interesting research on all of the Haverhills that exist, and the roots are not as clear as you might think they are. So, you know, if you're a subscriber to WHAV's Wavelengths newsletter, a monthly edition coming up at some point in the future is going to discuss that issue. Very, very fascinating research.
Well, the tough one in that, I'll be honest with you, is Haverhill, Florida. They don't really know when it started. They know when it incorporated, which was 1950, but Haverhill Road existed as early as the 1920s. So the community itself existed as a self-contained, locally named, non-incorporated entity, and that material simply doesn't exist because it was simply a group of people from the same area that happened to live on a piece of road out in the middle of nowhere. It was a sort of a farming community.
Yeah, very interesting. Whether it was people from Haverhill, Massachusetts, who wanted to bring a little bit of their hometown to their village before it was incorporated, or whether it's people from Haverhill, Suffolk, England, that said, "We've got to keep those keep those Yankees out of here."
Well, it's the time period on that one actually confuses me a little bit. Because that was not a time when people said, you know what, it's the middle of the Depression, let's go down into that vast wasteland of swamps and alligators and start a new life. So it makes me wonder if it's even older than that.
Well, I wonder if listeners, if any of you have a clue. Maybe you had a relative who helped found what would you call it before it was incorporated, a village, an unincorporated territory probably officially.
Yeah, Florida is very big on unincorporated areas. They rely on county services, but they don't have any municipal support system. So I live, technically I don't live in Lake Worth. If you type in my zip code, it says Lake Worth, but it also will deliver it if it's Wellington, Florida, or Green Acres, because I'm in an unincorporated area.
Green
county
Acres.
County water, county fire,
Chris,
county
find that
police.
Theme song.
No, that would be intellectual for this crowd.
Oh, geez, okay, well,
not
I don't know.
Not a big fan of the locals, let's put it that way.
I don't know, Green Acres, I'd be looking for Oliver and Lisa and Sam Drucker and, who are some of the other characters? Joe at the...
Mr. Haney.
At the Petticoat Junction, Mr. Haney.
You're losing your memory, that's what it is.
Yeah, well, so much for that, so... Well,
but,
David, I'm sorry that we missed that last week on their post, but it's still a very interesting subject about cities and towns being removed. Interestingly enough, I think environmentalists today have mixed feelings about Quabbin because it has become a beautiful, natural, in a sense.
Yes, and if the water is particularly clear on a bright day, you can look under the water with some sort of a... Well, the old-fashioned method we all used to use as kids, you take some saran wrap and wrap it on a coffee can with both ends cut out, you could peer underwater.
Oh, interesting.
There are still cellar holes that are visible.
No, actually, there was a documentary on public television maybe 15 years ago, perhaps 20 years ago, and they took the state police dive team and they went under and looked to see what was there. And frankly, the dive team reported that there wasn't as much clearance as had been reported. There was other kinds of debris under the waterline that was not supposed to be there. So that
sounds like a state job.
Yeah, I guess that was what you'd call it. Now, interestingly enough, you know, Jerry likes to talk about what happens when the lead bullets are fired at shooting ranges and end up in the ground and perhaps contaminate our groundwater. Chris, I think you got a phone ringing in the groundwater. And, you know, Quabbin Reservoir, before the water filled it, but after the clearance, I believe, was a practice range for the U.S. military at the beginning of World War II.
Well, keep in mind also, were the roads paved into, let's say, Dana? I believe they were all dirt roads, and if that's the case, you would keep the dirt roads from getting dusty in the summer by spraying them with a fine coat of oil.
No, that's a good point. That's how they did do that. That's how they did that. That's a good point.
So you've got a network of oil-soaked roads under there, theoretically.
What I find interesting is that in, I think it's, is it, North Dana's town common is still above the waterline. It was top of a hill, so it's above the waterline. And interestingly enough, the outlines of the streets are still pretty clear. You would have think growth in all these years would have just overridden it, but maybe things didn't grow because that soil was oiled, and nothing will ever grow on that soil.
Well, I don't know that much about the flora and fauna in central Massachusetts, but, I mean, it could be regional. The weather is so cold in the winter, it kills off any new growth. It has to start again every spring.
Yeah, maybe that's what it is. Well, David, thank you for the insight into the numbers of cities and towns in Massachusetts today, and probably have answered Brian's question that the newest city and the newest town in Massachusetts came before the demolition of the four towns.
Yeah, now the interesting question I have would be, what's delaying Devens being made into a town? Is it because it was federal property to start with?
You know, that's another good question. I wonder if anyone knows the answer. I mean, I know maybe it just never was serious enough to bring a petition to the legislature. But it is considered one of our major economic development zones as we've converted this military area into something akin to a town. But not official yet. I wonder if someone knows the answer to that. Good question. Maybe we'll have some special guests to talk about lost cities and towns and new cities and towns.
Talk about a specialty field.
I suppose that would be. But anyway, David, thank you so much.
As always, a pleasure, Tim. I'll talk to you later.
All right, thank you. Take care. All right, so we're going to take a brief break this hour for a movie review from our friends at Take Two Movie Reviews. We have a call backed up, a birthday call, so please stay on the line, caller, and we'll be right back with you.
Open mic!
Tim Coco and the Open Mic will be right back. Get in on the action. Call 978-374-1900 or email tcoco@whav.net. If you are enjoying this program, please consider making a donation right now. Your donations to not-for-profit WHAV help keep these vital community services on the air. Donate online at www.whav.net.
If you want to know what's going on at WHAV, sign up for the free monthly Wavelengths newsletter online at whav.net.
Catch the wave!
Every week on Making Contact, you'll hear voices from the United States and around the globe speaking on issues vital to all of us.
We report on economic, political, and social trends.
We also look at the issues that drive popular movements globally.
You can hear Making Contact on this non-commercial radio station.
Making Contact, Sunday mornings at 7 on 97.9 WHAV.
This is Take 2 Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. This week, action by the numbers. In 2012, Tom Cruise introduced the character Jack Reacher, as featured in Lee Child's novels, to big screen audiences. That movie, while no classic, was intriguing and well done. For the uninitiate, Reacher is a loner in the fight for justice. He's ex-military, a master of martial arts and weaponry, and hobos his way around the country from one wrong to be righted to the next. If you're thinking this sounds tailor-made for Cruise, you'd be right, and his heart definitely is in the role, from the self-done stunts to an effective translation of the character. The problem with Jack Reacher Never Go Back is the story and the way it's developed. There's no dawdling at the beginning of this one, and though the plot turns out to be network TV-level simple, the beginning simply feels rushed. The story is that of Reacher's replacement back in the military, a Major Susan Thomas being framed for espionage by corrupt higher-ups and their contractor friends. Using the requisite violence, he breaks her out of high-security facilities, and they head to New Orleans in search of a witness who can clear her. The role of female action hero foil Susan falls to Kobe Smulders, who does a well enough job representing women in the military. A subplot of Reacher as defendant in a paternity suit seems like it's pretty much there to humanize the character. He seeks out Samantha, who may or may not be his daughter, and if you can get past the motive for this addition, Danica Yaros from Shameless shines as a street-smart 15-year-old, who, of course, the bad guys know about. Edward Zwick is the director here, and while competently done, Jack Reacher Never Go Back doesn't have the creative flair of some of the better Cruise action projects. You can wait for this one on Blu-ray. This has been Take 2 Movie Review. I'm Mike Friend. Catch up with us at Take2MovieReview.com and feed us back on our page on YouTube.
WHAV Open Mic!
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco@whav.net.
Welcome back to the Open Mic Show, 97.9 FM, WHAV. I'm your host, Tim Coco. Producing in Master Control, as always, Chris Porter, the man with five radio jobs. All of them unpaid, I guess. But if you are listening to WMEX Saturday afternoon, 3 to 6, you would have heard Chris and Jim Callahan playing an oldies show there. Now, yeah, well, we don't like to promote other radio stations necessarily, but we do it when it helps our good friends, Chris and Jim. So thank you very much. Hey, well, I believe we have a birthday caller on the line. You are on the Open Mic Show.
Good evening.
Good evening. And this is Mark?
Yes.
Well, Mark, welcome to the program once again. You have a birthday wish?
I do. I'd like to nominate myself, since I don't know if anybody else is going to nominate me, and I do love chocolate cake.
All right, so put this man down for chocolate. Okay, that's great.
Absolutely.
Chris has the information. No, there's There's no rule against nominating yourself, but I want to tell folks that Mark really deserves it either way, because he has been very helpful behind the scenes. Most listeners wouldn't know this, but Mark is a connoisseur of oldies music, and although we don't call it oldies here, we call it soft gold, because after all, I'm not old, right? But Mark has picked out that some of our versions were not exactly original. They might have been re-sings or remixes, and he has alerted us to many of these, and the library is, I think we've addressed the vast majority, still working on a few of them. So, Mark, I really want to thank you for being that devoted listener who helps us out like that.
You're very welcome. Always a pleasure.
No, and but Mark, you know, I can tell, from your voice, and I know your parents, so you're a young man. Why would a young person like to listen to oldies?
I've always been into that music ever since I was young. In fact, I would say that the pre-Beatles era is my favorite, with the 50s being my absolute favorite decade.
Isn't that interesting? Well, you know, as someone once said, and I'm probably stealing it from a TV network, but if you haven't, and I'll paraphrase, if you haven't heard it, then it's new to you. And so I think a lot of people are discovering this music saying, wow, I love this. When did this come out? Well, it came out about 30 years before you were born.
Exactly.
But, you know, here's a question for you. What about some of the songs in the era that were in a style outside of the era? Let's say Frank Sinatra's New York, New York. Most people would think of it as a big band song, not a rock song, but it does fit the era that WHAV broadcasts. In or out, what's your vote?
I would put it in. I think it's great to hear that music. I mean, I love Frank Sinatra just as much as I love Elvis, and I love the Platters just as much as I love the Ames Brothers and the McGuire Sisters.
All right. Well, I'm really happy. But folks listening, Mark's been very helpful behind the scenes, sending on little notes. And I have to say, there's a word for this. It's called a necrology. I don't know if Mark would like to be associated with it, but Mark has also alerted us to the deaths, and unfortunately, there seems to be more and more of them, of some of these very big performers from the 50s and 60s and 70s. And so do you actively track these, or you just kind of occasionally catch that?
Just if I hear about something, I pass it on. I just heard recently that Kay Starr died. I love her music.
Kay Starr, I believe we have some recordings of Kay Starr appearing on the Great Gildersleeve show, which we run Wednesday nights.
Oh, very nice.
Isn't that interesting? I hadn't thought about that. But sometimes we do have some of those other genres sneak in to our format because they were on old-time radio shows that we put on every night at 10 o'clock and repeat it at 1. I'm going to go back and look for Kay Starr. Thank you for that tip.
Always a pleasure.
All right, and happy birthday, Mark.
Thank you very much.
Take care. Talk to you soon.
You too. Bye. Be well. Bye-bye. Bye.
All right, it's 8 o'clock. Let's go to local news with Dana Esmo. Let's find out what's happening this hour. We'll be right back.
It's 8 o'clock.
Broadcasting on the Armstrong FM system. This is 97.9 FM WHAV LP Haverhill.
Here's what's happening in local news. While Haverhill voters Tuesday head to polling places, Haverhill Public Schools students will have a day off from classes, and the school department makes way for a professional development day for school staff. Haverhill Assistant Superintendent of Schools Jared Fulgoni explained to WHAV Monday, with people coming and going to vote at several normally busy schools, it made sense to hold a staff professional development day in place of classes. Quote, when we lay out the school year calendar, we try to tie professional development to non-school days, Fulgoni said. On Haverhill's general election ballot, Democrat and Lynn Police Chief Kevin F. Coppinger faces Republican Ann M. Manning Martin of Peabody in the bid to succeed Sheriff Frank G. Cousins, who is not seeking another term. In the race for the 3rd Congressional District seat, Haverhill Republican Roseanne L. Ann Earhart Wolford makes her second bid to unseat incumbent Democrat Congresswoman Nikki Tsongas of Lowell. For the 5th District Governor's Council seat, Republican Richard A. Baker of West Newberry is challenging Democrat incumbent Eileen R. Duff of Gloucester. Meanwhile, in local legislative races, incumbent Democrat Representative Linda Dean Campbell of Methuen faces independent challenger Nicholas Teresi of Methuen in her bid for another term. Voters in the Andover area will decide whether incumbent Democrat State Senator Barbara A. Letalian and Republican State Representative James J. Lyons Jr., both of Andover, will serve another term. Letalian is challenged by Republican Susan M. LaPlante of Lawrence, while Lyons faces second-time Democrat candidate Oscar Camargo of Andover, who ran unsuccessfully 2 years ago in a primary race against Democrat Representative Diana DeZoglio of Methuen. DeZoglio, along with Democrat incumbent Representative Brian S. Dempsey of Haverhill, each of whom represents sections of Haverhill, run unopposed Tuesday, as does Haverhill's State Senator Kathleen A. O'Connor Ives of Newburyport. Republican Representative Leonard Mira of West Newbury is also running unchallenged in Tuesday's election. Polls in Haverhill are open from 7 a.m. until 8 p.m. The Haverhill City Council will not meet Tuesday night due to the election. Their next meeting will be Tuesday, November 15. Stay tuned to WHAV for national and local election coverage beginning at 7 p.m. Tuesday. WHAV will interrupt network programs as local election results are known. WHAV will air Democracy Now!'s five-hour election night special beginning at 7. More details are at whav.net. A Haverhill man was among three people charged by Haverhill Police Sunday in connection with a drug trafficking investigation. Police arrested Newton Romero, 25, of 4 Swayze Street, Haverhill, Sunday afternoon on High Street and charged him with disturbing the peace and a weapons storage violation. Two Lawrence residents, Carlos Martinez, 24, and Christian Paredes, 19, were each charged with trafficking in cocaine, trafficking in heroin, morphine, opium, and conspiracy to violate drug laws. Martinez was also charged with disorderly conduct. All are scheduled to be arraigned in Haverhill District Court. In other police news, Deanna Clark, 25, of 43 Douglas Street, Haverhill, was arrested at 12:13 a.m. Saturday at 122 Rosemont Street and charged with possession of a Class B drug and a marked lanes violation. Remember, WHAV is the only Haverhill-based news source, and it's always free. In the Edwin V. Johnson Newsroom, this is Dana Esmail.
From Feature Story News in Washington, I'm Daniel Renches. Hillary Clinton's retaining a small advantage in newly published polling data in the final hours of campaigning before Election Day begins. Donald Trump's appealing to voters who feel disadvantaged by globalization and the current political elite in Washington. The Clinton campaign is being aided by last-minute appearances by President Obama and celebrities including Bruce Springsteen and Lady Gaga in key swing states. Our Washington correspondent Simon Mark says the momentum is in Hillary Clinton's favor after the FBI dismissed the possibility of a criminal case over its email investigation.
Well, still pretty good news for Hillary Clinton. I mean, the latest survey that CBS News has published suggests that she's 5 points clear of Donald Trump nationally going into Election Day. Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, of course, barnstorming through those all-important battleground states on this final day of America's presidential election campaign. But the Clinton campaign still can't really, I think, take anything for granted. Donald Trump is determined to do what he can to energize his supporters, the last chance he says they'll ever get. He argues there'll never be another opportunity like this one for the disenfranchised, as he would define them, people who have lost their jobs, seen their opportunities exported out of the country, watched industries retrench, particularly in states like Ohio and Pennsylvania. He says this is their last chance to send a message to the political establishment that they want to overturn America's political apple cart.
Philippines President Rodrigo Duterte says he's cancelled an order of weapons from the United States after the sale was stopped by the State Department. The top U.S. Democrat on the Foreign Relations Committee blocked the planned sale of 26,000 assault rifles after reports from human rights organizations citing several thousand extrajudicial killings since the start of Duterte's war on drugs. U.S. correspondent Mimi Charmen reports from New York.
President Duterte said the Philippines will just have to look for another source of firearms. That's according to local reports citing a speech delivered on Monday by the president, who suggested just a few weeks ago that he could source weapons from Russia if the U.S. were to block the sale. The development comes as relations between the U.S. and the Philippines have grown strained in recent months over Duterte's pushback against Washington's criticism of his war on drugs. A few weeks ago, President Duterte clarified a headline-grabbing statement he made about severing ties with the U.S., saying that what he meant was a separation of foreign policy, not an end to diplomatic relations. Mimi Chahman, New York.
Prosecutors in Germany have confirmed that they've widened their investigation into Volkswagen's emissions cheating scandal to include the carmaker's current chairman. This is FSN.
WHAV Weather!
I'm WHAV meteorologist Gary Best with WHAV Weather. With generally clear skies, it's going to be a chilly night, low temperature close to 32. And then for Election Day Tuesday, mostly sunny and turning milder, a bit over 60. Increasing clouds, about 40 at night. Mostly cloudy with a chance of showers developing Wednesday. High temperature 54 to 58. This is Gary Best. Your next WHAV weather coming up in 30 minutes.
Broadcasting on the Armstrong FM system. This is 97.9 FM WHAV.
WHAV, Merrimack Valley, open mic.
From the Edwin B. Johnson Newsroom, WHAV presents the Open Mic Show with Tim Coco. Make your voice heard. Call 978-374-1900. That's 978-374-1900. Or email tcoco at whav.net.
And about 8 minutes past the hour on 97.9 WHAV, you are listening to the Open Mic Show. Some of you may even be watching it, WHAV.TV or Haverhill Community Television, HC Media Channel 22 in Haverhill on Comcast. And there is a Facebook feed tonight, but unlike our older Facebook feeds that would alert you that it was on, this simply appears at on the WHAV Facebook page. We've been trying to reduce some of the bandwidth usage here to make sure there's plenty to feed our transmitter. So that's one of those things. But I believe we have a call holding. You are on the Open Mic Show. You're on the Open Mic Show. All right, I can hear my voice on the person's radio. Are you there?
Hi, Tim Coco, it's me.
Oh, hi there. And who are you?
I'm David's grandson.
Your safety officer, Dave's grandson?
Yes.
Well, isn't that nice of you to call? What's going on?
I'm calling to wish you all a happy Halloween, and I wish you have a Thanksgiving.
Well, thank you.
How are things going up in Plugs?
Are they getting a toilet put in?
All right. So I see Safety Officer Dave has an assistant. So you're going to be Deputy Dave. How's that? I'm sorry. Your name is Dave too?
No, I'm Dave's grandson.
Hey, what's your name?
Richie.
Deputy Richie. Deputy, okay. Well, yeah, we're still waiting for some reports. I don't believe it's in the city's capital plan to make those improvements at Plug Pond. At least they weren't in the reports that we saw.
Hey, Tim Coco.
Yeah.
They didn't put the lines up on Washington Street.
And they still haven't done those lines yet. I wonder if, I think Councilor McGonigal is the head of Public Safety Committee. I wonder if he's aware of that. Maybe he's listening and he can give us a report on that. So, well, thank you very much, Deputy Richie. And we really appreciate your well wishes. And we wish you and your family, your grandfather, your parents a most wonderful holiday season. Yes.
Are you guys going to put a toilet up at Plug Pond?
Well, we don't put them up, but we're hoping the city will do that. All right. Well, thank you very much for your...
All right, Tim Coco, you have a good Merry Christmas.
All right. Well, you too. That's a little early. Very good. All right. Merry Christmas to you too. Thank you, Deputy Richie. All right. So we have Safety Officer Dave and his grandson, the deputy. We'll try to remember that, make him a regular caller. Wasn't that nice to get that call? And you could call, too, 978-374-1900, 978-374-1900. Open lines. We had earlier, somehow we get distracted on this program with all the great topics that come up and all the great history. But anyone want to take a stab at calling and telling us whether you've already voted in early voting, whether you're planning to vote tomorrow, and optional, who you're supporting and why? Or if you're not supporting anybody, I believe we have one WHAV listener who is planning in writing in his dog. for all of the races. He's not happy at all with any of the candidates. I don't know if that person is listening and if he knows that I'm talking about him, but he said he always writes in his dog. He's not happy at all with the choices. He always votes. But writing in his dog. I wonder if any of you have a story like that, or maybe there's a particular one where you type in, or you write in, not type in, Mickey Mouse or Goofy or one of those. You know, I wonder how many do that. So give us a call, 978-374-1900. Just a program reminder, WHAV 97.9 tomorrow, 5 hours of live election coverage beginning at 7 o'clock coming from the Pacifica Network. And we'll break into the programming from time to time to let you know how some of the local races aren't. There aren't too many contested races locally, but the sheriff's race is certainly garnering quite a bit of attention, and we'll see how that one goes. I think we have another call on that line. Okay, you are on the Open Mic Show.
Hello, Tim. This is Corporal B.
Well, Corporal, it's finally reporting for duty. All right, thank you, Corporal.
Yeah, what are we going to do about all this voter fraud?
What voter fraud?
Vote early, vote often.
Well, you know...
Registration online, they can vote online, they can switch them. And now I just heard, the other day before, I don't know what program, I just switch it till I find something I like. And I guess there's people on there... They call vote switching from state to state. Have you heard that?
Well, you know, I have to tell you, I have heard some stories like that, but I haven't seen any. Matter of fact, I believe the people who have studied this nationally have said there are people who are registered in more than one state because they may have moved and they didn't cancel their registration, but it's very unlikely that they ran back to their former house in their former state and voted again on the same day or the same period. So I haven't seen any proof that there actually is voter fraud. There are people registered in more than one spot because of the way the system works. But I think there was one instance this week of a woman who's been charged with voter fraud, and it is such a severe penalty that it seems like it'd be difficult. But do you think Corporal, that there's a lot of voter fraud?
Well, because what I think, Chris, is not important. It's what it's, you know, the burden of proof. You have to have proof. But these people I heard talking about voter switching, they were talking like they were already doing it, and they were doing it within the law. I don't know what they were talking about.
Well,
you haven't heard that, huh?
Well, I've heard the situation where. Some national group looked at all the states and found there was a Maureen Smith in New Hampshire and a Maureen Smith in Florida, and what if she voted twice? Well, is it the same Maureen Smith, I guess, and I'm just making up that name, so if there is a Maureen Smith listening, I'm sorry. How likely it is that they're going to, maybe they moved to Florida, retired, or they're a seasonal person, and 1 year they stayed in the winter and voted there, and then. But what's the likelihood? So far, it seems like the idea of curbing voter fraud is a solution in search of a problem.
Well, I guess they can dig and change or do things that can look like this within the law. For example, when we had a lot of illegal immigrants in California by the thousands, when Bill Clinton first ran for president, he promised them that if they became citizens, he'd promise them if they were illegal immigrants, if they have a visa or something, can they vote?
No.
They can't vote. They have to be legal immigrants.
No, they actually have to be citizens. I think there may be some municipalities, not in Massachusetts, but there may be some. I think you're on to something. I think there are some municipalities, and I hate to pass along a wives' tale if I'm wrong.
He promised something to them if they voted for him, and it worked.
Well, actually, the largest.
Remember 2000, they looking at these ballots with magnifying glasses?
Well, the largest amnesty was during President Reagan's administration. I think people forget that. That was the largest amnesty ever. But I don't know if promises that if I get you in, then you'll vote for me. I mean, if they become citizens, maybe.
Yeah.
I mean, I just like to know what the truth is, because what I guess what worries me, and I think you're raising a valid concern.
If they can prove any of it.
If they can prove it. But here's what I think is happening. And, you know, there are going to be people who disagree with me, and that's okay. Your opinions, all of your opinions are valid on this program. But what I think is happening is, I think what's happening is that because of this fear or risk that someone has voted twice, let's take 2 million people off the voting rolls just in case. And that is voter suppression. We've got to be careful how we react to these. But, you know, the studies that I've seen, there just isn't anything to it. There's potential, but to go suddenly in some county in North Carolina that we're going to take, 3,000 people off the voting rolls because they might be felons. Because their last name is similar to someone who's a felon, and in some states, felons can't vote. So, yeah.
Can't do that.
But they do it. They do it. We've seen it. And now there's another one I heard today. This is a really good topic, Jerry.
Yeah,
there's another one I heard
today. They only can be, there's so many people involved, and I think it's high official people, and it's hard to catch them.
Well, I mean.
They know how to get out of the laws. Plus, you look at everything today, people aren't being held accountable for things they do, like getting run over by a car.
No, you're absolutely true. It's absolutely true. A lot of people are not being held accountable, or we don't hold them accountable, and we should.
But
I heard one today that I thought was very interesting. It was on the Tom Hartman Show, which is on WHAV from noon to 3 live each day. And on the Tom Hartman Show, there was a county, not in Massachusetts, that there used to be 20 polling places. And they reduced it because of budget to one place. Now, can you imagine? Now, Haverhill has, I think, 20 polling places. Can you imagine if we suddenly said, you know what? This is really too expensive. Everybody go to the high school, and everybody can vote there. Well, the problem with that is that, well, people aren't going to wait in line that long.
No.
And so, in effect, we have voter suppression. Now, we saw this with early voting, which is a good thing. But the line to early vote last Thursday at City Hall was incredible. Early voting was in the basement, and people, I don't know, it's usually people in line, rather than running down the hall of the first floor of the up the stairs. So there were people up to the second floor waiting to go down to the basement.
Aren't these people working at the polls volunteers?
I believe we pay our poll workers.
You pay them?
I believe we pay. Someone correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe we, it's a modest amount.
Oh,
but
yeah, so what do they mean it's too expensive to have more polls?
Well, whether it's heating the buildings or setting up the equipment or buying voting machines, I mean, I'm there are expenses to having an election. So, maybe some county said, well, this is expensive. But I find it suspicious because the counties that were too expensive were minorities. At least that's how it was portrayed on the Tom Hartman program.
Just sounds like another excuse.
An excuse for what?
I don't know.
Well, I'd be curious about that. But in your heart, do you think there's a lot of voter fraud?
In my heart?
I mean, how many times did you vote today?
Did I vote?
Yeah. Did you?
I'm going to vote tomorrow.
Okay, so you didn't do early voting either. Hey,
did you hear
Brian? Actually, that's a good question. Did you hear Brian's question?
That machine, yeah, that's a good question. I'm going to find out myself.
Yeah, I would love to. I would love to get a report from either one of you on that.
They're going to move those machines. I don't know if they have enough to. See, they had voting down, the fire station, the city hall.
Yeah, there was,
different places.
Yeah, they had a few last weekend, that's right.
I don't know if they're going to take that machine to each one.
Well, that's a good question. I'm assuming that.
I use it when I go up to high school. When I go tomorrow, I'm going to ask him that.
All right, so, and this is for people who are blind, is that right?
People that are disabled. can use it.
All right. How does it work?
Well, it's got a keypad on it. And it, because for the blind, we have the earphones, so we can hear it.
Oh, I see. I see.
It's got voice to it, and when you push the button, it tells us what to do.
All right. Now, is the voice?
It's like our talking computer with speech software. You follow the prompts.
Okay.
And I guess other disabled people can use it too. Why would they use it? I don't know. I hear that it's for people with all disabilities.
Well, that makes sense. Anybody who it would be easier for them to use
a keypad,
maybe someone with Parkinson's perhaps would find it helpful. All right. Well, you know, Jerry, good food for thought. We really appreciate your call.
All right. Thank you very much, and have a good one.
Well, you too. Thank you so much.
Welcome. Bye-bye.
Now let's work in another call here. You're on the Open Mic Show.
Good evening. Good evening, Tim. How are you?
Good. Jerry, I hope you realize you got us all thinking about Quabbin. I don't know if you heard all the David's numbers.
Oh, no, I didn't. I didn't. I wished I had, but I can't get to it tonight.
Really?
No. And in addition, I've been watching the meeting. I thought I was going to have a scoop for you. It's still going on. There's a discussion now on whether they should... City of Methuen City Council should implement a letter of non-opposition against a company called Be Well from Lowell. But the discussion is not over yet about it, and they haven't taken a vote.
What's the company do?
Medical marijuana.
Oh, so there's a new proposal for... Well, actually, yes, this is the one that's been kind of circulating for a year or so.
It's not the same firm.
Oh.
This firm already has one, I guess, in Lowell. Be Well. Organic medical marijuana.
Well, that's a good question. So tomorrow... by the way, did you vote early or are you voting tomorrow?
I already voted early.
Oh, all right. Well, you don't have to tell us, but how you voted...
Oh, I'd be proud.
But
I'm a big fan for charter schools. That's one thing, right?
What about the legalization, regulation, and taxation of marijuana?
Was that on the ballot too?
Yes.
I did. I think I voted no on that.
Oh, yeah.
The reason is because I have, I realize and I listen to people talk about how good it is for asthma and you admit anxiety, etc. But, I can't get over the idea that that's how my son James started, who deceased last year,
So you think marijuana might be a gateway drug?
A gateway drug, really.
All right. Yeah, I've heard people on both sides of this, but it's interesting that the official position of the people opposing it is that they were more concerned that we're creating new billion-dollar commercial companies like the cigarette makers who become they control the profits.
We know what cigarettes they do, right?
That's right.
And cigars, right?
So the opponents have really made a case for the fact that we're creating giant. They mentioned the gateway issue too. It says in the response in the
talk to colleges too, and say the same and agree with me, same thing.
Because and I know that Dr. Maddox in Haverhill, he's the school pediatrician, would agree with you.
Yeah.
But in the ballot question, pro and con, the con mentions last, ignores the deadly...
That's a really wide open type of thing. It's not specific for medical marijuana. That's for... putting it into lollipops and everything else, I guess, isn't it?
Well, that's I know the medical marijuana people have sold some of these things.
Yeah.
What about how did you feel about conditions for farm animals?
The same kind of people will be enjoying their tenderloin steak every Sunday, or their that's how I felt there. But really, you know, I know that you only have a few minutes, and I wanted to tell you about how proud I am about some of my classmates. I listened to the program early tonight, and you were talking about...
my high school class?
Yes.
All right, tell us about your high school class, Gerald. We got about 2 minutes.
My high school class, a Nobel Prize winner in chemistry.
You mentioned that. What's that person's name?
Elias Corey.
Oh.
Sat next to me in math.
Really?
Yes.
Boy, I wasn't paying attention in math. Oh,
no.
Okay.
You didn't pass Algebra 1 like I didn't.
Oh, I already have told this story then. You remember it, huh?
Yeah.
I had to retake it.
Oh. And then the other one was, you know, I always have to be proud of Robert Frost, 1892, but I wasn't there then.
Oh, he wasn't your classmate. Okay.
Then there was Ray McDonnell, M-A-C-D-O-N-E-L-L.
Yeah, that's the soap opera star you've told us about,
yes.
Right?
And he was also the feature, played the role. Lead role in Dick Tracy.
In Dick Tracy, really? Okay.
Yeah. So anyway.
Well, you have a great... I don't want to embarrass you. What year was your graduating class?
1945.
Oh, wow, it was a good year. We won the war.
Yes, I did. And I was in the Navy. And my dad used to say, I didn't think it was funny, and I've said this before. My dad used to say... When you joined the Army, joined the Navy, the Japanese decided to surrender.
Well, there you go.
I didn't think it was very funny, though, right?
Well, he was just proud of you.
Yeah. So the two that I've been really proud of, and also proud that Robert Frost, I was at him at the dedication of the Robert Frost School in South Lawrence, you know. He made a speech that day at the dedication, and guess I told you what the road not taken, he, you know.
Yes,
That was the feature. But anyway, I was pleased that Elias, MIT graduate, Nobel Prize, and then Ray McDonnell, Scotch pronunciation, McDonnell.
Yes.
What was it? I forgot what the name he was. He characterized in the children, all my children. Yeah.
All right. I'm afraid, actually, Jerry, we're out of time, and we are going to be running on WHAV.
I wish I could, the
sheriff's debate.
Wrong, though, because I couldn't get you on my computer tonight.
Well, actually, do you have a good FM radio? You should be able to get us there.
Oh yes. Yeah.
Try that, but next week we'll.
No, I don't have radio, no.
All right, we'll have to get you one. All right.
Yeah, all right.
Thank you very much, Jerry.
We'll know the outcome tomorrow on the vote.
Yes, we'll be here. Listen to our coverage beginning at 7 o'clock.
Uh-huh, so it'll be on.
All right, thank you very much, Jerry.
Thank you.
Take care. Bye. Okay, folks, we're going to go. We're going to have local weather. The show ends. And tonight, your last chance to hear the three of the candidates for Essex County Sheriff discuss their views. It was a great forum moderated by the League of Women Voters of Greater Haverhill. And, Chris, you can confirm the schedule, right? Okay. We didn't forget to program, and that's great. All right, so thank you very much, folks. Stay tuned tomorrow night, 5-hour special beginning at 7 o'clock on WHAV 97.9 FM. We'll do break-ins for local updates. Have a great night.
Open mic! Join Tim Coco live on the Open Mic again next Monday night at 6:30. The opinions expressed on the Open Mic show are not necessarily those of WHAV, its underwriters, or affiliated stations. The Open Mic show came to you from the Edwin V. Johnson.